Did you grow up living in the shadow of a family member? Or are you still living in the shadow of a family member? You know, sometimes people can do some very wonderful things, can't they? Some people are highly intelligent. Are you living in the shadow of your intelligent father? And some people are very athletic. Are you living in the shadow of your athletic brother? But you know, some people sometimes do some very great spiritual things, don't they? Sometimes you could live in the shadow of a person who did something very great spiritually. But then you have the other side of that too. You could live in the shadow of someone who's done something very terrible. Imagine if your dad was a serial killer or something. That'd be difficult, wouldn't it? To grow up in the shadow of your father being someone who had done something very great or perhaps even very terrible. And then here you are growing up, and what does everybody expect? Everybody expects you to be just like them. But sometimes we're not. We may not be as smart as dad. We may not be as athletic as our older brother. We may not be a spiritual giant like some other member of the family. And certainly I'd hope that you wouldn't grow up to be a serial killer if that were the case. So if it was something terrible, don't definitely grow up doing that. But let me just run some names by you. Imagine living in the shadow of these people. Imagine being the son or the daughter perhaps of Adam or Cain or Abraham or David. Wouldn't that bring its own set of challenges? Well, how easy do you think it was being Shem, Ham, or Japheth? You say, who are they? Those are Noah's three boys who were with him on the ark. And we discussed for some length of time last week, Noah has some great things said of him in the Bible. Imagine that being your dad. What would everybody else expect you to be? Well, wouldn't they expect you to be just like your dad? And to some degree, maybe we all should be like Noah. But from another aspect, we have to be our own people, don't we? So let's talk tonight about some more people from the Pentateuch. And let's talk about Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Three things we want to do very simply tonight, hopefully in a timely manner. First, we're going to talk about the lives of Shem, Ham, and Japheth and try to discover some things that are recorded of them in Scripture. And second, we're going to talk about the lines of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And that's where things, to me at least, get a little interesting. And then third, we're going to try to give some lasting life lessons for today. A way that we can take the lives of Shem, Ham, and Japheth and apply them to our lives today as 21st century Christians. So let's open our Bibles up to the book of Genesis. And we're going to start, we're going to be sporadic back and forth at several different texts. But let's start in Genesis 9 and verse 24. And let's try to understand this. Perhaps it is the case that Shem, Ham, and Japheth were three triplets. All right, I guess that could be the case, but it doesn't seem to be the case given in Scripture. So there was, it seems, some order in which Shem, Ham, and Japheth were born. So let's try to determine that. And remember this as we study this. These men, like no other father, saw the world before the flood, during the flood, and then after the flood. So they lived in the antediluvian world, which simply means before the Genesis flood, but they also lived in the post-diluvian world, which is the world in which we live. Same planet, but it's really two different worlds. So let's try to determine who's who. Genesis 9 and verse 24, and Noah woke from his wine and knew what his younger son had done unto him. So Ham, and that's who this is in the context, and we'll talk more about that moving forward. Ham seems to be the youngest of the three sons of Noah. It doesn't say youngest, though, doesn't it? At least in the King James, it says younger, but younger than whom? In the context were, verse 23, Shem and Japheth. So it seems to imply that Ham was the youngest of the three sons of Noah. But look at Genesis 10 and verse 21. The Bible there says, unto Shem also, the father of all the children of Eber, the brother of Japheth, the elder, even to him were children born. So what does that seem to indicate? Well, when you look at the way the King James language words it, it would seem that Japheth is the eldest of the three, according to the King James Version, and if I look correctly, according to the New King James Version. However, the American Standard Version words it somewhat differently. And there the text says, and unto Shem, the father of all the children of Eber, the elder brother of Japheth, to him also were children born. So it seems that one thing we could be certain about is Ham was the youngest. Perhaps Japheth was the oldest, or perhaps even Shem was the elder of the three children. But regardless, there's some other things that we can determine too. Look back in Genesis chapter 5 and verse 32. Let's try to take some scriptures and try to string them together and see what we can come up with. Genesis 5 and verse 32, and Noah was 500 years old, and Noah begat Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now look at Genesis 7 and verse 6. If your Bible's like mine, it's in the same opening. And Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters was upon the earth. Now look at Genesis 11 and verse 10. We get a little bit more information here. These are the generations of Shem. Shem was 100 years old, all right, watch, and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. Now it seems to imply that Shem was 100 years old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. Therefore, it could be argued that Shem would be the middle child. Noah was 600 when the flood began, and 2 years after the flood, Shem was 500 years old. Or rather, Shem was 100 years old. Thus, Noah would have been 502 years old when Shem was born. Now, look back at that. Look back in Genesis 5 and verse 32. And Noah was 500 years old. It seems that that seems to teach that when his first son of these three named were begotten, obviously with Mrs. Noah, he was 500 years old. It seems to imply that Noah was 502 years old when Shem was born. Now, let me tell you something that I find very interesting about that. When you start laying out and looking at it, for example, in a bar graph form, when Adam was born, and then you go the 930 years, and you see when everyone else was begotten, obviously through the husband and wife relationship. A man that is initially known as Abram, who we probably all know a little bit better as Abraham, could very easily have learned about Jehovah from Shem. You think of what all Shem could tell. You think about that. That man lived for a reasonable amount of time. Perhaps not 100 years, but pretty close to 100 years in the antediluvian world. He lived through the universal flood and then lived for a significant amount of time in the post-diluvian world. As we move forward, we'll see that Abraham's father was an idolater. But Abraham learned the truth about Jehovah from somebody. Well, from whom did he learn it? The Bible is silent regarding that, but a reasonable conclusion is that Abraham learned about Jehovah from Shem. Now, I want to show you something else significant, still considering Shem, Ham, and Japheth and the lives that they lived. Look at Genesis 9 and verse 1. Once you understand the truth of what the book of Genesis teaches, Adam was the first man. Eve was the first woman. She was taken from Adam's rib. From them came everyone till the flood. And then what happened? You had Noah, Mrs. Noah, Noah's three boys, and his three boys, three wives on that ark. And everybody came from them. Genesis 9:1. And God blessed Noah and his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Look at this same chapter, verses 18 and 19. And the sons of Noah that went forth of the ark were Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan. We'll talk about that in a minute. These, look carefully at verse 19. These are the three sons of Noah, and of them, of Shem, Ham, and Japheth, was the whole earth overspread. And here directly we're going to look at the table of the nations in Genesis chapter 10. All human beings ultimately go back to Adam and Eve. And if you can get it from two, can't you do it from six? Bible silent regarding Noah and his wife, and it seems that it came from Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and their three wives. Isn't that amazing? Don't you see the power of God and the providential protection of God? Now, Japheth and Shem don't have a whole lot recorded of them in Scripture, and for that matter, neither does Ham. But something is recorded in Genesis 9, verses 26 and 27. We'll look at it backwards. We'll look at Shem and Ham first, and then Shem and Japheth first, and then we'll work our way back to Ham. Genesis 9:26, and he, that's Noah, said, Blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. Verse 27, God shall enlarge Japheth, and he shall dwell in the tents of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant. While we don't read too much about Shem and Japheth, we do see here a blessing is prophetically pronounced upon them by their father. And their father we know as Noah. First, consider Shem. It says, He shall dwell in the tents of Shem. Who is that he? The simple answer would probably be Japheth. But really, when you look at that, it is God. God shall dwell in the tents of Shem. Therefore, Genesis 9 and verse 27 is a messianic prophecy. And who is the Messiah? The Messiah is Jesus. So God would dwell in the tents, that is figurative language to show that the Messiah would come through the descent of Shem. And that is exactly what happened. Now, when you look at Japheth, God shall enlarge Japheth. That probably, the simple meaning behind that, probably refers to the numerous descendants that came through the line of Japheth. So there's a prophetic blessing of Noah given to two of his sons, but there's also that third son, Ham. And there is a shameful event recorded of Ham and incidentally of his father Noah too, in Genesis 9, beginning in verse 22. Look at what the Bible says. Back up to verse number 20. And Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard. And he drank of the wine and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. While some degree of ignorance could be there, Noah did wrong. Even if he was a little bit ignorant about the wine, he was uncovered within his tent. That's wrong. Right, that's not good. Verse 22, but here's the point. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. You don't initially see this in the English, but apparently in the Hebrew, Ham told what he saw with a sense of delight, meaning that he was apparently, whatever it is that he saw, he told in a way that really painted his father in a bad light. He was almost giddy about whatever he saw and whatever he went and told. Verse 23, And Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon both their shoulders and went backward, meaning that they understood their daddy's in whatever's going on here. They don't need to see this. This is not how Noah was all the time. He's made a mistake. So Shem and Japheth took a garment, and laid it upon both their shoulders, and went backward and covered the nakedness of their father. And their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. Verse 24. And Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his younger son, Ham, it seems, had done unto him. Now look at verse 25. And he said, cursed be Canaan. Now who did this? Ham is the one who did it. Why is he bringing up Canaan? Why doesn't he say cursed be Ham? He says cursed be Canaan. The best explanation I can give you regarding that is sometimes the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree, does it? You understand what that figure of speech means? Meaning that apparently what Ham saw and told with delight, Canaan was already walking in his so-called proverbial father's footsteps. So Noah says prophetically, cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren. And then we've read the rest there. Now, think about this. The universal flood cleansed the earth of all flesh on dry land that was not in the ark. But it did not eradicate sin from the hearts of those on the ark, did it? It did not. Now, regardless of what type of philosophical or scholarly explanation could be given to a servant of servants and how Canaan shall be his servant in verse 26 and Canaan shall be his servant in verse 27. This is history. The Canaanites served Shem and Japheth and were servants of servants. This most likely has its fulfillment in the book of Joshua chapter 9 verse 7 and then verses 16 through 23. If that's not it, it would be Judges 1 verse 28 and the verses that follow. And if that's not it, when you look at the table of the nations, from Javan came the Greeks, and the Greeks ended up conquering the then known world in the intertestamental period. So regardless of when and how these prophetic curses were fulfilled, they were fulfilled, and God's word is true. Now, that's their lives. Let's talk quickly about their lines. That is of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Genesis chapter 10 is the table of nations, and it is not all-encompassing. It is written in what is considered a climactic form, meaning that Moses, by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is leading us to a bigger point, and the bigger point is the messianic seed line. Keep that in your mind. So in Genesis 10, 1 through 5, we see the line of Japheth. From the perspective of Palestine, Japheth's descendants went north into Asia Minor and Europe. Well, let's look quickly at Genesis 10 and verse 2, and we're just going to look at two of these individuals. The sons of Japheth, Gomer and Magog, here's one we're going to look at, and Madai. Perhaps that's how that's pronounced. Madai is the man from whom the nation of the Medes descended. You recall in the book of Daniel, chapter 11 and verse 1, of Darius the Mede? They descended from this individual through Japheth, Madai. And here's the second one we're going to look at. And Javan. Javan is the man from whom the Greeks descended. Do you also recall in the book of Daniel, chapter 8 and verse 21, about the rough goat being the prince of the kings of Grecia, and the nation of Greece ruled between the testaments. So you can see this table of nations as it is spread out, and Tubal, and Meshach, and Tiras. Now in Genesis 10, verses 6 through 20, you see the descendants of Ham. And from the perspective of Palestine, basically the descendants of Ham went south. Obviously, once they went south, they could go a little west and obviously a little east. But they descended into Africa, Arabia, Egypt, and obviously Canaan. Look at Genesis 10 and verse 6. And we're going to do this very similarly. We're just going to look at two of these descendants. And the sons of Ham, here's the first one, Cush. As you go through the Bible, Cush is generally known as Ethiopia. And if you look at the King James Version of Genesis 2 and verse 13, that's what's in the text. is Ethiopia, but if I look correctly in the New King James and in the American Standard, it says Cush. So Cush is Ethiopia, that general area which was south of the land of Palestine. But look at the verse. Cush and Mizraim, and this is probably pronounced Put, silent H, and the one we're going to look at briefly is Canaan. Now, the Canaanites, obviously, I would think, dwelled in the land of Canaan. You can see that in Genesis 11:31 and several other passages moving forward in the book of Genesis. The land of Canaan is also synonymous with the land of Palestine. Palestine basically means Philistine land. Now, when you begin to look at the Canaanites, and really all those inhabiting the land of Canaan in Moses' day, they were exceedingly wicked, and they were exceedingly vile. Turn with me quickly, if you would, to the book of Leviticus, and let's get an idea in our heads about the wickedness of these people. The book of Leviticus, and let's look at chapter 18. Obviously not the whole chapter, but look for the sake of time at verse number 3, and then we're going to look down in verses 22, 23, 24, and perhaps 25. Leviticus 18:3. After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein ye dwelt, shall ye not do. Mizraim seems to be the descendants of those who went into Egypt. So there's problem number one. Ham's descendants didn't do all that hot, by the way. Don't do like those of the land of Egypt, wherein ye dwelt, shall ye not do. And after the doings of the land of Canaan, whither I bring you, shall ye not do. Neither shall you walk in their ordinances. Now that's pretty plain. Here I'm giving you this land that's overflowing with milk and honey. They've built up cities for you. It's ready. But now you're going to go take this, but don't you act like those people who lived there. Now look in this same chapter, Leviticus 18, verse 22. Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is abomination. You see that? Verse 23, neither shalt thou lie with any beast to defile thyself therewith, neither shall any woman stand before a beast to lie down thereto. It is confusion. Now this is horrible stuff, isn't it? Verse 24, defile not ye yourselves in any of these things. Don't do these things, for in all these the nations are defiled, which I cast out before you. Well, who was living in the land of Canaan? Among other people, the Canaanites. Why did God want them totally expelled and eradicated from their land? Do you see why? Verse 25, look what happens. And the land is defiled. Therefore, I do visit the iniquity thereof upon it, and the land itself vomiteth out her inhabitants. Do you see why God got rid of the Canaanites and others, by the way, from the land of Canaan? Their time had come. Israel was to come into this land, which was overflowing with milk and honey, and take it from these people. Why? Because they were so sinful. They were so wicked and they were so vile. Go back with me to Genesis 10. Genesis 10, verses 21 through 32, we see the line of Shem. Shem's people basically went east. If you look at Palestine, do you know what's due west? The Mediterranean Sea. That's why you don't really see anybody so much going west. They went north to end up going west, and they went south to end up going west. But if you go due west from Palestine, you're swimming in the Mediterranean Sea. So these people ended up inhabiting the Tigris-Euphrates Valley, Mesopotamia, the land between the rivers. And Abraham is descended through these people, through Arphaxad and Eber. Look at Genesis 10 and verse number 22. The children of Shem, Elam, and Asher, and Arphaxad, and Lud, and Aram. Now, look at Genesis 11 and verse 10. again, these are the generations of Shem. Shem was 100 years old and begat Arphaxad 2 years after the flood. Look down at verse 16. And Eber lived 430 years and begat Peleg. Now look at verse 26. And Terah lived 70 years and begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Which all that means that the fleshly line of the Hebrew and Jewish people, and ultimately the Messiah, they came through which of Noah's three sons? They came through Shem. Incidentally, if you look back at Genesis 10 and verse 22 and you see Asher, you know what major nation that ended up being that you've been hearing about in the book of 2 Kings? That is the Assyrians. That ended up being the nation that we know as Assyria. Now, it'd be hard not to mention something about Genesis chapter 11, so I'll mention it very briefly. And that is where you see the Tower of Babel. Perhaps you may call it Babel. It's probably Babel, but that's okay. Genesis 11 is a reasonable conclusion for the origin of the distinction in ethnic groups. Now, where did everybody come from? Ultimately, everybody goes back to Adam and Eve. Well, after that, where does everybody go back to? Shem, Ham, and Japheth and their three wives. So a reasonable conclusion is that at the scattering of the people in Genesis 11, where all the earth was of one language, what was that one language? Nobody would be able to tell you for certain. Who knows what it was? But the whole earth was of one language. They try to build a tower up to the heavens for whatever purpose. God says this ain't going to happen. So there he confounded the languages of all the nations. And a reasonable conclusion is this: that those people of similar skin pigment spoke the same language and they ended up going in their various directions. But let me tell you something that is absolutely true. When you go to receive blood from someone, you do realize that someone who has nothing similar to you regarding the pigment of their skin can have the same type blood that you have. Therefore, it is impossible to tell a person's skin color by their blood. Now, what does that tell you? That at some point in time, we were all the same in that we came from the same background. What is our background? Adam and Eve and Shem, Ham, and Japheth and their three wives. Now, third, let's give some, very quickly, some lasting life lessons for today. Four words. Here's word number one. It's family. Mankind has descended through Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And before that, obviously, it was Adam and Eve, wasn't it? Now, while there are differences in every ethnic group, there are similarities. Let me tell you what some of them are. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, be not bitter. Be not overbearing is really what the meaning is. Don't be overbearing toward your children, lest they be discouraged. Regardless of what skin pigment you have, Colossians 3, verses 18 through 21 is a way to have a happy family. And if we would all understand what the Bible teaches regarding that, our families would be a whole lot better, wouldn't they? Word number two is faithfulness. Shem, Ham, and Japheth were blessed to have Noah as a father. And really, when you begin to look at it, they were blessed because of Noah's faithfulness. But you know what inevitably happened? God expected Shem and Ham and Japheth, and incidentally, their three wives, to be faithful too. So you may be enjoying some blessings of your daddy's faithfulness right now, but let me tell you what's going to happen if it hadn't already. God expects you to be faithful as an individual. And if you are a husband, he expects you to lead your family in a faithful manner. Was your father faithful? Great. That really is a blessing. But let me tell you what matters. Are you faithful? That's what matters. 1 Corinthians 4:2, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Where'd you get your soul? You're a steward of your soul. Therefore what? You need to be faithful with your soul. Where'd you get your body? It's on loan from God. How ought you to treat your body? As a steward. And stewards must be found faithful. Word number three is failure. Noah and his descendants occasionally failed to meet the righteous standard of God. And then when you look at it, at Shem and Ham and Japheth's descendants, it got even worse. And you see more and more and more failure, don't you? But does failure define who we are? Let me give you just a quick illustration. What's the first thing that comes into your mind when you hear the word Noah? Do you think, oh, he got drunk and ended up being naked in his tent? Is that the first thing that comes to your mind? I didn't think so. Can a good man make a bad mistake? Absolutely. But what happens when good men make bad mistakes? We've fallen down. What do? It's the end of the world. No, sir. We get back up by the grace of God. We do what God expects of us, and we don't dwell on the past, do we? No, we don't. We will stumble into sin, unfortunately. Romans 3:23, 1 John 1:8. But what do? When we fail and stumble into sin, 1 John 1:9. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Don't get in the rut of thinking that all you are is a failure, because you're not. Last word is forgiveness. Every person of every nation needs forgiveness through Christ. That's the only way you're going to get it. The only way we're going to get forgiveness. Anybody, anywhere on this planet is going to be forgiven. It's going to be through Jesus, isn't it? Romans 5, verses 6 through 9. I think you're familiar with that by now. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. You know who's implied in Romans 5 verses 6 through 9? You and me and whosoever will. Whosoever desires freedom from sin can have it, but we must obey the Lord. Don't live in the shadow of your family's religion. You may be living in your daddy's academic shadow, or your brother's athletic shadow, or somebody else's spiritual shadow. Don't you live in the shadow of your family's religion. If that religion is wrong, leave it and don't look back. If that religion is right, you be sure you know why it's right according to the scriptures. And don't live off your daddy's faith one more day. You live off your own faith, built and rooted and grounded in God's holy word. The scripture says to honor your father and mother, but that does not mean you go to hell with them. If their religion is wrong, leave it. Leave it and don't look back. John 12:48, Jesus says, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. Are you ready for God's test of honesty? Let's see. You have to hear the truth. John 6:44 and 45. All men are drawn when all men are taught the truth. You have to believe the truth. John 8:24. Except ye believe that I am, ye shall die in your sins. You have to repent of sin. Acts 26:20, Paul taught it to the Jews and to the Gentiles, that they were to repent and turn to God and do works meet, suitable for repentance. We must confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That confession is made with the mouth into salvation, Romans 10:9 and 10, but you're not right until you have been immersed in water for the remission of sins. How much plainer could 1 Peter 3:21 be? the like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us. And brethren, it doesn't stop right there. We have to walk in the light and be faithful unto death, regardless of what everybody else does around us. 1 John 1:7-9. We're here for you because we love you. But you have to come. Do so now, as together we stand and as we sing the song of encouragement.